In my video about intergroup bias, I explained a bit of how we know that humans tend to like members of their own groups more than members of other groups, whatever they perceive these groups to be. Intergroup bias is a pervasive problem and can have some serious consequences. Truly awful examples in recent history include the cases of James Byrd and Matthew Shepard. On June 7, 1998, in Texas, USA, 49-year-old James Byrd was beaten behind a convenience store, chained by his ankles to a pickup truck, stripped naked, and dragged for 3 miles. He was alive for most of the dragging, and died only when his head and right arm were severed from his body by a culvert in the road. He was attacked by 3 men from his hometown because he was black. On October 6, 1998, in Wyoming, USA, 22-year-old Matthew Shepard was attacked, tortured, burned, and left tied to a fence to die. He was found in a coma on the following day, but died on October 12 from severe head injuries. He was attacked by 2 men from his hometown because he was gay. These are very extreme examples. Thankfully, most of us will never be on the other end of such tragic encounters, or on any end. But you don't have to kill people before intergroup bias becomes a serious problem. There are, for example, instances of anti-homosexual bullying in British schools that include having clothes that alight, being urinated on, being burned with cigarettes, being dragged across the school playing field, or even being raped. Nobody should have to live with this treatment. Yet, in big and small ways, we all do, at least some of the time. Daily discrimination is visited upon people of one race by people of another race, on people of one religion by people of another religion, on the fat by the thin, on the poor by the rich, on people with mental health problems by people without. And this happens all over, in the UK, the US, Jamaica, Uganda, the United Arab Emirates, China, and Australia. Intergroup bias happens everywhere. Bias-reducing mechanisms are as necessary now as they've ever been. And there are lots of ways to reduce intergroup bias. Education, for example, or changes in the social, political, or economic climate. Intergroup contact, however, stands out as a particularly effective prejudice-reducing mechanism. So what is intergroup contact? Kind of, but nothing that dramatic. Intergroup contact, or just contact for short, simply means interaction with a person or people who you acknowledge as being different or from a different group. And this has been found to reduce anxiety about interacting with other groups, to improve attitudes towards other groups, and to reduce prejudiced behaviors against other groups. Now you might think, that's bleedingly obvious. Of course, if you spend time with people from other groups, you'll like those groups more. But everything seems obvious once it's known, an effect known as hindsight bias. The truth is, for a long time, people believed exactly the opposite, that interaction between people of different groups would breed suspicion and hostility. Furthermore, even after it was demonstrated that contact improved attitudes towards an individual from a different group, other questions remained, such as whether the effect of contact endured beyond the contact scenario, or whether this improvement of attitudes generalized to other members of the same group. Over the course of 60 years of rigorous research, psychologists have answered a lot of those questions. At this point, there have been hundreds of studies done on the effect of contact on intergroup bias. They've been done in different ways, in different places, in different decades, with different groups, and with different types of contact, and their results point in one direction. Contact generally reduces intergroup prejudice and improves intergroup relations. In other words, according to the best evidence there is, if you want two groups of people to get along, get them to spend time together.
Feel alright, saying, let's get together and feel alright.
And that's all well and good. But what do we do when contact isn't possible? Or when it's dangerous? Or when it's disastrously inconvenient or expensive? At those times, it'd be really good if there was some way of getting the benefits of contact without taking on the risk or the inconvenience associated with contact. And there is such a thing. It's called imagined contact. And if you'd like to know more about that, I've posted a link to another video on the topic. And with that, thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Keon West, social psychologist. Rate and subscribe if you like. Don't be afraid to send me a message or an email. I am, after all, a social psychologist, so I like to know what you think. Take care.